last week we ended on this subject of work, and today we will expand it a lot more. We're still dealing with the subject of dominion. And like I told you, humanity was created to have dominion. That was God's objective for mankind. And God has not, and I'm emphasizing, God has not changed his mind concerning you having dominion. Not even the fall brought a change of mind. His purpose for humanity was let us make man in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion. Praise be to God. And if we are to understand this, then we need to go back to the very beginning and ask ourselves, why are we here? Why are you living in Uganda at this point in time? Why are you living where you are living at this point? It is not an accident. God takes the same thought process and brings it to Jeremiah chapter 1. And it tells him, before you were born in your mother's womb, I knew you. So before you were ever here, God knew you. In other words, he understood, he had an assignment, he had a design, he had a plan for your life. So if there is anyone setting you up to fail, it is not God. Jeremiah 29:11, we know that scripture by heart. It says, for the plans or the thoughts I have towards you, they are not what? They are not for evil. In other words, if you have evil thoughts, they are not coming from me. So God has not set me up for failure. Say it in a minute. God has not set you up for failure. You have been set up for success. You know, it is amazing when he says, before you were formed, I knew you. That means God went on a search, looked at all the species, male species on this planet, 6 billion of them. No, they are less than 6 billion. 6 billion is the total. Maybe 2 billion, the 3 they are about. I say, not you, not you, not you, not you, you. Now, that dysfunctional father that brought you in existence, he has the right DNA. And that mother has the right DNA to form you. Because when he looked at his design, this is the best species he wanted. So you are not here by accident. You may look unique, you understand what I mean by looking unique, okay? Praise be to God. You know, many of us don't want to look in our mirrors because we look unique. We don't like what we see. I don't know how many like what they see when they look in the mirror. Oh, wonderful. The brothers. Praise be to God. Some of us don't like what we see when we look in the mirror, but it's okay. When God set to form you, he had an assignment in mind. He was not setting you up for failure, he was setting you up for success. You are the right DNA composition. You have the right complex. You have the right height, the right size, the right everything for the assignment that he has for you. The challenge we have is that we spend our lives trying to compare ourselves with somebody else. They have their composition for their assignment. So I'm the right fit for my assignment.
than that comforting. And God has not set you up to fail. No. He has set you up to have dominion. I want that to understand you now. And you see, where it all begins with the fall from the fact that we have everything figured out. One time when Jesus is walking, this Matthew chapter 22, it is a story in Luke, it is a story in Mark. Jesus is tested by the Herodians and the Pharisees. So they come to him and they ask the question, should we give tax to Caesar? 15 to 22. And then it was to test him. It was a test like you would a husband. If you wanted to set up a politician, you would come to them and say, do you still beat your wife? Whether they say yes or no, if they say yes, that means they are still continuing. If they say no, that means they used to. So, it's a setup. Praise be to God. Now, here they ask him, should we give taxes to Caesar? And isn't they not talking about there are so many taxes they used to pay, but they used to pay this particular tax. They used to pay it using the coins that bear Caesar's image. And then he said, bring me the coin. So they put in the coin, he looked at it and asked him, whose image is here? And they said, Caesar's. So he answers in this scripture that we know very well. He says, then render therefore to Caesar what belongs to Caesar. And often that is where we want to stop when we want taxes from the people. From the government saying that. But he adds and says, render to God what belongs to whom? To God. Now that the way you're rendering to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, render to God what is God's. You are giving this coin back to Caesar because it has Caesar's image on it. It belongs to Caesar. You and I, created in the image of God, have an ownership. We belong to God. So he's trying to say, whatever has the image belongs to someone. So the coin which had Caesar's image, Caesar Tiberius, belonged to who? To Caesar. So give it back to Caesar. Then he says, and give to God what belongs to God. So the question is, what is it that belongs to God? It is that bears his image. And Genesis 1:26 says, God said, let us create man in our image after our likeness. So every believer has both the image and the likeness of God. And that speaks to whose you are. You belong to God. You don't belong to the government. You belong to God. You have an owner. It's amazing. When you look at the people who manufacture cars or manufacture products, if they send it out and it malfunctions, what happens? They call it with an apology and fix it and bring it back to you. So if Toyota has sent out cars and they discover there is a defect, what happens? They recall them. Okay, but don't worry, for many of us, by the time we get what we have, they have already recalled and then they have sent back. So we are okay. I also get it in the news, okay? I would never add to the same back then. Praise be to God. You understand? But why do they recall them? Because they sent out the market that which wasn't what? Perfect. Now let me bring the point home. For you and I, God has never recalled us. Why? Because what he sent out is the perfect thing. Praise be to God. Why? Because, you see, all these manufacturers, whatever product they manufacture and sell out, bears their name, bears their identity. And if it fails to function, then the reputation of the manufacturer is on the line. So when you understand that you are God's ownership, you have his stamp, his image, his likeness upon your life, then you know you have not been set up to fail. No matter what is around you, no matter how long it has lingered, let 2022 be a year when it registers in your mind that I have not been set up to fail. Say it like me, I have not been set up to fail. Don't worry again, please. Not set you up to fail. And that's why when we go back to the beginning, there's a pattern that we begin to see. And here, after God has created man, we saw the third thing he gives him. He gives him his presence. And after he's given him the presence, what happens then? He gives him the fourth item, which is what? Work. Say work. Say it again. Say it again. So work is not a curse. Now say it after me. Work is not a curse. You see, for you to fulfill your assignment in life, work has to be involved. Look at the scripture we all know very well. Now, I don't want to get strong scripture. I want the scriptures we know very well by heart. Ephesians 3:20. It says what? Now unto him who is able to what? To what? Do. To what? Do. What does do mean? Thank you very much. Who is what? Able to do. What? Exceedingly. What? Abundantly. What? Above. Or that you can do it. Ask or what? Think. What? According to the power that is at work. Where? So the power to work is available within you. It is like a car fueled for a journey. Until you get the key and start it, you won't know there is work going on. It will be a very beautiful specimen. You can wash it, you can polish it, you can do everything, but it will just remain a specimen. Please don't let your life be a what? Just a museum specimen. Oh, this was nice. So can I start it? No. I just wanted my boys to watch. But you can check the food. Is it food? Yes, it's food. Wonderful. For many of us, because we don't allow the engine to start, we are just a museum. Don't allow your life to be what? Has anyone seen anything in the museum? If it were a movie, I would rush out and never come back. In the movies, they move, but in life, praise be to God.
You are not a museum antique. You were made, you were fashioned to what? To what? Ephesians chapter 2.
Another wonderful scripture I'm going to. Today I'm going to use only those that you know. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. What does it say? For by grace you have been saved. Can I say something to you here?
You have been saved by what? By grace. Okay, not of what? Through faith. That's not of yourselves. But what? It is the gift of what?
It is the gift of God. And many of us, we end there and say, hallelujah, I am saved by grace.
Saved by grace, saved by grace. Hallelujah, Lord, I am saved by grace. But let's move to the next verse. Why are you saved by grace? He goes on to say, not of works, lest anyone should do what?
Boast. Verse 10.
You are God's workmanship. Say it again. I am God's workmanship. You were created in who? For what? Say it again. You are God's workmanship. In other words, if you don't work, then God is not working. God is not working. You are created in Christ Jesus for good works. Which God did what? Which God prepared beforehand that you should walk in. The point is, you are not set up to fail. Look at what has happened. God beforehand, the Bible says, has prepared. Say prepared. What has God prepared beforehand? He has prepared a journey that you will embark on. He knows who you are before you ever were. He has prepared your assignment on earth. Yes. Then he comes and causes you to be born as a seed in your mother's womb. Important here, so you grow. And at a certain point, he leads his spirit to touch a preacher, to preach the gospel to you. Then by his spirit, he prompts you to listen to this gospel. Then he melts your heart to receive this message. And then he saves you by grace. Don't think you had a lot to do. Yes, you did have all you did to say was yes, okay? But it was God behind by everything behind the scenes. Have you people watched the puppet show? You have? You see, the fall has made us think we are the movie stars, okay? We are not. We are not even directing the movie. Okay? You are just acting a scene out of God's word. So it is God's movie, okay? And you are an actor in God's word. Do you understand? So you are not the director. You are God's what? Workmanship. You are God's what? Workmanship. So who is the supervisor here? Thank you very much. God is the supervisor. Now, after he has saved you, what happened? He places you in such a situation that you exhibit his good works. Yes. So you are now a representation of what he had in mind in the first place. His destiny for your life is that you have dominion. Is that these people look at your works, and then your works point to what? To him. So when we talk about works, a lot of us get nervous, but let's get back. Your work should point to who? To God. Because you belong to who? So when you are malfunctioning, you are not malfunctioning because God has not given you what is required. You are malfunctioning because you are not listening to him. Jesus' secret for success is found in John chapter 5, verse 17. This is what he says. What did Jesus say? He says, my Father has been working until now, and I am what? And I am working. Why am I working now? Because my Father is what? Okay, we'll go to the next line. He says something important. Therefore, they sought to do what? To kill him. Because he not only broke the Sabbath, but he did what? But also called God his Father. And by calling God his Father, what was he saying? He was what? He was making himself equal with God. Did he say I'm equal with God? No. He's trying to say something that what I am doing points to my what? My Father. The way I do what I do should reflect my Father's fullness, should reflect my Father's character, should reflect my Father's desire. Praise be to God. The way people come and say, are you so-and-so's daughter or so-and-so's son? Why? Because you look like them. Okay? But God wants us to take it to another level, not look like. But what you do looks like the way your Father does it. Praise be to God. You see, when there is a very interesting account in the Bible, when David came in and told Saul, let no man be bothered. I am going to fight the giant. And Saul looks at this young man and asks him, any military experience? Says, well, none that I can talk about. Okay, that's the way I paraphrase it. Okay, none that we can talk about. But two things happen. I have been looking after my father's sheep. And when the bear showed up, I killed it. When the lion showed up, I killed it. Basically, this lion and the bear were the setup for Goliath. While everybody saw a giant, David saw a lion and a bear. You see, the challenges you are faced with today are not to bring you down. Those are the lions. Those are the things that give you the perspective that when the real giant shows up and everybody is running away, you are like, what will the king give to slay that giant? Praise be to God. Now, that's not the interesting thing. After he had tried to give him the clothes and his armor, and he said, no, I can't use this. And you know, Saul was a giant. He was taller than any man in
Israel at his time, head and shoulder. Now, he's getting his armor and giving it to David, so he must have covered him totally. To the world, he looked protected. But he said, no, I can't use this. I'm not used to this. He gives it back to him and he walks out. And as he walks out, Saul turned and looked at his general and asked, whose son is that man? He didn't say, what is his name? No. He said, who is his father? Because there must be more of that kind. The question I need to ask you, whose child are you? When the people look at what you do, the question they should be asking, wait a minute, whose daughter are you? Whose son are you? What you are doing points to something extraordinary. Do you get what I'm trying to say? Back to the point here. He says, you are God's what? Workmanship. Okay? We created in who? Christ Jesus. For what? For good works, which God ordained beforehand, that you may what? Walk in it. Walk in it. In other words, God has already set you up for success. He has gone before you, made everything that is required for you to be a success. Say, I'm set up to succeed. God has gone into your future, okay? Prepared everything, then come back to time, okay? Brought you in, and then says, now walk. And what happens? The enemy of our souls then makes us think, no, no, it's too deep. What is there? What if we don't? What if it doesn't work out? You are working with the what ifs, but you are forgetting this, that you have been set up for success. Verse 11, the Bible says, therefore, remember that you once were a Gentile in the flesh, who are called the white, the uncircumcision. Now he's trying to paint the picture of what you were before and what you have now become. Praise be to God. He says, before you were a Gentile, in other words, before you were not part of who God called his own. Then he goes on to say, verse 12, that at that time you were without Christ. That's understood? Now, Christ is talking about the anointing of God. He's talking about the anointed and his word, anointed. You do not have the power of God to execute what you were created to be. Then he says, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel. In other words, you have no comparison. There is nothing you could look at to say, okay, if God did it for them, he will do it for me. You are outside that commonwealth. Okay? Then he goes on to say, and strangers to the covenant of promise. In other words, he had promised you nothing. There is nothing he has ever promised you. He goes on to say, having no hope, having no God in this world. So you had Nabinji, you had Mwanga, you had Chibuko Mumbari. I said, but now, say it again. But what? He says, what? in Christ Jesus, you who was faultless have now been brought right. In other words, you are now accepted. Everything that you are not, now you are. Now you have hope. Now you have God. Now you have the covenant of promise. Now you belong to a team, a commonwealth of Israel. In other words, you belong to a group of people who are overcomers in life. You belong to God. Let life not deceive you. Let your present circumstances not obscure that for you. You belong to God. You have been set up for success. First Corinthians 3. What does the Bible say? He says your what? He says your what? Okay, let's first go to John 5:19. Then we'll come back to you. John 5:19. Then we'll wind up with this. Is somebody getting blessed this morning? Okay. John says, Jesus gives us the secret. What does he say? He says, most assuredly I say to you, okay, the Son can do nothing except that which he sees his Father do. Let's first digest that for a moment. He says, the Son can do what? Nothing. Except that which he sees the word. Now, can I have two people? Please come, just two volunteers. Okay? Imagine this is the Father, and this is the word. The Son. Jesus is saying, the Son, can the Father do something, please? He says, do you see what the Father is doing? Can you do what the Father is doing? Do it. No, no, no. Do what I see him do. He says, before, now you stop. He says, now start again. Stop. Start. He says, whatever I see the Father do, then I what? If the Father is not doing it, then I'm not what? I don't get it. That is the recipe, my dear brother. You see, what we are doing, the reason why we fail is because we are doing what the Father is not doing. You have the Father's image. You have the Father's likeness. The Father has already set you up for success. And he's saying, look, watch what I am doing and do what? And do it. So the question is, what is the Father doing? And what are you as his child doing? So when you understand that, please take a seat. When you understand that, then everything changes. So even your prayer changes. You are asking, Father, Father, what are you doing? Praise be to God. You see, when you go to God and tell him, God, Lord, what do you want me to do? Okay, in essence, you are saying, Father, what are you doing? Why? Because 1 Corinthians 3 and 9 tells us what? You are God's fellow workers. So God, on one hand, is doing something. So you become a fellow worker because on earth, you are doing what the Father is doing. So the reason God gets man to put him in the garden, small enclosure, yet he gave him dominion over the world, he wants him to see what he's doing and do in like that. So when he does what the Father is doing, then he's able to have dominion. The reason you and I are not having dominion is we are not seeing what the Father is doing. We are doing our thing. Our thing. My thing. You are supposed to be doing what God is what? Doing. If God is out there reaching the lost, you have to be out there doing what? Reaching the lost. If God is out there comforting those that are comfortless, you have to be there comforting those that are comfortless. If God is out there loving the unloved, you have to be there on the front line loving the unloved. Why? Because you are God's fellow workers. He adds up and says what? You are God's food. Say, I'm God's food. In other words, you are God's dead. He placed man in what? The garden. Yet in essence, man became the devil. Why? Because the seed of greatness is in him. And then he finally winds up and says, you are God's word. God's dead. You are God's word? You are God's word? You are God's word? I love that. You are God's word? You are God's word? So you are working progress. God is dead. Say, that's what I am building. So you are what God is what? Thank you very much. Your God's what? Your God's, first of all, he says God's what? Follow up. Then second, he says your God's what? And then your God's what? Stop. Say, neighbor, God has not set you up to fail. You are a success story. Because God has set you up for success. Raise those hands in the presence of the Father. King of God, Lord of honor, Lord of blessing, and Lord of love. We thank you for this wonderful moment. We thank you for the authority of your word. Your word declares that there is no word that proceeds from your mouth which is devoid of power. Your word, Father, affirms that you follow your word to perform it. Even this morning, King of God, your word has been declared. Follow that word that is planted in the hearts of this man and woman to perform it in their lives. Lord, I thank you for this truth. I pray it be watered, Lord, that this truth yield fruit in this season, Lord. 30-fold, 60-fold, and 100-fold, to the praise and the glory of the name of Jesus. And in Jesus' name I pray, God's people said, amen. If you are here, you have never given your life to Jesus. Anybody here not born again? This story only works when you give your life to Jesus. That's the beginning. So, anyone here who is not saved, desire to give your life to Jesus to make your spirit of prayer in our prayer. Touch your neighbor, ask them my body. If they are trying to look aside, say, neighbor, are you born again? Until you get the response. Okay. Thank you. Take out your offering. We are going to pray to the Lord. The Bible says God loves a cheerful heart. Last week I told you it is the heart that gives value to the gift. And I say it again, it is the heart that gives value to the gift. That's why Jesus says, even if you bring an offering and you remember you wronged your brother, leave your gift here, first come inside your blood, and then bring what? The gift. Why? Because it is the heart that gives that value to what you offer. Father, in the name of Jesus, as your people give, I pray a blessing upon them. Because you promised in your word that when we give our time is when we give an offering, you say, prove me their way. And see if I'm not open the windows of heaven and pour out blessing upon you, so that there shall not be room enough for you to contain it. Lord, we come in obedience to our strength. And as your people give, I thank you for this opportunity. When you are releasing the blessing upon our lives, that we shall not have room enough to contain it. Bless your people this week as they go about their work. Open this truth to their mind. May it be revealed in what they do. And may what they do reflect who's there. May what they do point to you, our Lord and Father. And I thank you, Lord, for them. And I bless them, Lord, in the matchless and wonderful name of your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray. Amen and amen. The ushers will pass by. Please give your offering, give liberally, give cheerfully, and God richly bless you. Have a wonderful week. Shalom.